Hi everyone, my name is Alexander and I'm glad to welcome you to a new meetup from DataZen community. DataZen community is a place where our expert speakers talk about their experience, challenges they are facing every day, the most popular technologies and interesting news from the world of data. Our today's expert, Murat, will talk about data quality on Apache Spark and will share his real experience in it. Hi, Murat. We're happy to have you as our guest today. Floor is yours.
Hi, Alexander. Today I'm going to be talking about data quality on Apache Spark. Let's get started. I have worked over 10 years under data domain in different data teams, and since 2016, I have been working on big data field. I have built data pipelines for rule-based analytic and AI applications in banking industry. Since 2021, I have been working in EPAM systems as a senior software engineer. During presentation, I'm going to be talking about what poor data quality is, as well as possible causes and consequences, research and incidents of the impacts of poor data quality dimensions, and components, a case study, DQ tool options, and comparison of these tools. Before getting started to talk about the causes and consequences, let me define what data quality is. Basically, data quality refers to the ability of a dataset to serve whichever need a company hopes to use it for. So without it, data cannot fulfill its intended purpose. Let's have a look. What leads to poor data quality and what are the possible consequences in case of its existence? The first one of the causes is non-integration of databases, which means that using various databases that don't integrate with one another runs the risk of poor data entry habits, such as duplicate records or having to rekey information with the resultant loss of time and effort. The next one is inconsistent data capture protocols. It means that inconsistencies in how data should be formatted and entered will affect data quality through inaccuracies. For instance, open text fields can be used and interpreted in different ways by different users. The third one is poor data migration and integration. What it stands for is migrating data to a new system or consolidating systems via integration carries inherent risk to your data. Values can be irregular, missing, or misplaced. And even simple spreadsheets can cause inconsistency problems. If your data isn't clean, you will likely need rules implemented to change this. And the last but not least one is data decay. What it means that is, data is always changing. It is not static, and even over a relatively short period, much of it will have altered. It's estimated that around 40% of email users change their email addresses every 2 years, and 20% of postal addresses change annually. You should definitely keep your data up to date. Otherwise, it will become outdated, and you will be wasting time and resources trying to communicate with people. In the right side, the consequences of poor data quality are listed. The first one is poor decision making. Poor quality data leads to poor decisions. A decision can be no better than the information upon which it's based. A critical decision based on poor quality data can have very serious consequences. Next one is business inefficiencies. Poor quality data causes inefficiencies in those business processes, which depend on data from the reports to ordering products and just about everything in between for which facts are required. These inefficiencies may result in very expensive rework efforts, validating and fixing data errors instead of focusing on core duties. And the third one is mistrust. Poor quality data creates mistrust, especially in industries where regulations govern relationships or trade with certain customers, such as finance. Maintaining good quality data can be the difference between compliance and millions of dollars in fines. If the data is wrong, time, money, and reputations can be lost, reflecting adversely on your business and lowering your customer confidence. And the next one is missed opportunities. A business may miss profitable opportunity for new product developments or customer needs that a competitor with a more advanced understanding of data may capitalize upon. And the last one is lost revenue. Poor quality data can lead to lost revenue in many ways. For example, communications that fail to convert to sales because the underlying customer data is incorrect. Poor data can result in inaccurate targeting and communications. According to the Gartner, organizations believe that they lose average $15 million per year due to poor data quality. And one another Gartner research shows that 40% of anticipated value of all business initiatives is never achieved as a result of poor data quality. And lastly, IBM research reveals that businesses lose $3.1 trillion annually in the US alone. Let's have a look at the incident when companies compromise the quality of data. In 1999, NASA lost a Mars orbiter that cost $125 million due to data inconsistency. This is one another example of financial consequence of poor data quality. Citizens who would have regularly received 155 euros instead were sent 15,500 euros. Some even got as much as 34,000 euros. Let's dive into the dimensions of data quality. The first one is consistency. Consistency refers to the data values in one data set being consistent with values in another data set. A strict definition of consistency specifies that two data values drawn from separate data set must not conflict with each other. The second is completeness. Data is considered complete when all the data required for a particular use is present and available to be used. It is not about ensuring 100% of your data fields are complete. It is about determining what data is critical and what is optional. The next one is uniqueness. The dimension of uniqueness is characterized by stating that no entity exists more than once within the data set. The next one is accuracy. Data accuracy refers to the degree with which data correctly represents the real-life objects that they are intended to model. In many cases, accuracy is measured by how the values agree with an identified source of correct information. The fifth one is timelines. What it stands for is that degree to which data is current and available for use in the expected time frame. This could be real time, making data available very soon after the event it describes or processed in a batch until the next refresh. Sixth one is validity, which is defined as the extent to which the data conforms to the expected format, type, and range. For instance, amount should be between 1 and 12. These six dimensions are almost being expected for all qualified data sets. However, for data sets consumed by AI models, there are two additional dimensions that definitely must be considered in data quality checks. First one is relevancy. It represents how much a column in a training data set are essential for the target variable. AI inputs are horizontally wide data sets, which may contain hundreds of columns, so you must consider whether you really need this information for your target or you are collecting it just for the sake of modeling experiments. In case the column is irrelevant with or insignificant for your target variable, you should exclude it. Otherwise, it leads more resource consumption in your pipeline for the sake of useless information. The second one is distribution. Value distribution doesn't represent directly the quality of data sets. However, due to the nature of AI modeling approach, models are supposed to be regenerated with the fresh data. Hence, it must be checked whether the statics of new data sets still align with the statics from previous training data sets. A good data quality solution, it might be a framework or a library, should consist of these sorted components. At the beginning, we as a data quality engineer or a data engineer have to analyze the data set and gather statistics of each columns. For instance, data types, maximum minimum values, distinct values, null value counts. Data profiling is the feature that provides this capability. Subsequently, we should create quality checks according to output of data profiling. They might be threshold or more sophisticated anomaly detection checks. Quality checks help us to detect if there is unexpected, wrong, or missing information in our data set. Hence, they should be determined according to business rules and data quality requirements. In case even one quality check step gets failed, at least, alerting component should be triggered and captured data error should be notified to the teams. These notifications might be telephone calls or email messages. Metrics which are collected during quality check process should be retained and be accessible for monitoring changes among data snapshots by time through analytic dashboards. One another advantage of gathering these metrics is new quality check rules can be defined by comparing these snapshots. For instance, you can define a quality check rule which detects unexpected row counts increments by time. Before getting started to touch on how the process flows, I want to mention some details regarding this topology briefly. This architecture was created when I used to work in an AI project. Data quality checks, which are presented with the light blue arrows, were added for validation requirements of the pipelines. Let me summarize the execution of this topology. As it is shown in the left side of the slide, data is collected from different sources and is being written to HDFS by Scoop and the DCP APIs. After this ingestion process, some data validation tasks, including count check, source target accuracy checks, are triggered. Subsequently, Spark-based master data processing tasks run to create AI master dataset. And right after this process, some statistical checks are applied to the data. If there is no error captured, data sets are transferred to the object storage and AI processes are getting started. If there is an error captured during the EQ process, data engineers analyze root cause of the error, which it may be either integration related or source data related. In case the data is related with the integration, in case the error is related with the integration, data engineers apply some fixes to the pipeline and rerun the process. However, in case the error related with the source data changing, data scientists involved to the process and track the pipeline to ensure whether new models are accurate as it should be. We decided to choose AWS DQ for data validation process. The reasons behind the decision are our processing pipeline are developed with Scala. Hence, AWS DQ is the most convenient option for our pipelines. Besides that, AWS DQ provides well-covered quality check options like standard deviations, correlation, histogram, entropy, approx quantile for distributional and AI-focused data validation needs. While implementing AWS DQ to our pipelines, we customized some parts of DQ according to our requirements. For example, dynamic threshold and column input feature, which doesn't exist in the library, was added. By this feature, we have been able to feed column names, constraints, and threshold values with a JSON formatted input file. Besides that, email notification feature was added for alerting. You can build your own data quality approach from scratch. However, regardless of your architecture, it is going to be most inefficient and most time costly option. In terms of tool options, these three are the most common and major ones, having capability of running on Apache Spark seamlessly. I'm going to be compare them in the following slides. Apache Griffin is an open source data quality solution for big data, which supports both batch and streaming mode. It offers a unified process to measure your data quality from different perspectives. The project has been backed up by eBay since 2016. It is the most mature one and more like a platform you configure rather than the library you use in your code. One another big difference than the other ones is quality check capability on real-time data. It has a Kafka connector, hence it could be a good option corresponding to Kafka-based streaming data validation requirements. However, Griffin has a poor documentation, and there are not enough distributional and statistical data analysis options inside of the framework for AI projects and data quality tasks. The feature of Apache Griffins are accuracy measurement, which means that an assessment of the accuracy of a data set compared to a verifiable source. Data profiling is an analysis and assessment of data values within a data set in terms of consistency, uniqueness, and logic. Anomaly detection feature is pre-built algorithmic function for the identification of events that they don't conform to an expected pattern in a data set. Visualization feature is nothing but dashboards that can report the state of the data quality. Email notification is the alerting mechanism when unexpected data quality issues are captured. Griffin has three parts. The first part is define. It is mainly responsible for defining the dimensions of data quality statistics. For example, the number of non-empty fields in the data source, the number of non-repeating values, maximum, minimum value, top five, etc. The second part is measure, which is mainly responsible for the implementation of statistical tasks and it generates statistical results. And the last part is analyze, which is mainly responsible for the storage and display of statistical results. Great Expectation is an open source Python library that helps data teams eliminate pipeline debt through data testing, documentation, and profiling. Expectations are assertions for data. They are the workhorse abstraction in Great Expectations, covering all kinds of common data issues. It provides different data source options, such as SQL databases, object storages, as well as different processing types like Pandas and Apache Spark. Besides, it has good documentation. Its features are automated data profiling. It profiles your data to get basic statistics and automatically generates a suite of expectations based on what is observed in the data. Data documentation. The library renders expectations to clean, human-readable documentation. These are HTML-based documents and created for each time validations are run. Slack notification. You can set triggers for Slack notifications as a validation action. It allows you to send a Slack message, including information about a validation result, whether it succeeded or not. And the last but not least one is CLI. It provides creating a great expectations project, adding new data source, adding and editing expectation suites, build and opening data docs through CLI. Here is an example of how you can add an expectation on a specific column in Jupyter Notebook environment. There are various expectation options. All you need to do is import a library and call Spark DF dataset function by adding Spark data frame as the input. Then you can add your expectation. In the example, the expectation is checking data lower and upper bounds. Create risk score represents column name. Mean value represents lower bound. Max value represents upper bound. Mostly represents the percentage of records that must be between lower and upper bounds. Result format is the parameter which specifies the fields to return in the result. In this example, I choose summary. The other options are Boolean only, basic, and complete. You can choose each one depending on how detailed you need to analyze. In the right image, you can see the expectations result. Element count represents total value count in the column. Missing count represents the count of missing values. Missing percent represents the percentage of missing values. Unexpected count represents the count of row violated the rule including missing values. Unexpected percentage represents the percentage of row violated the rule including missing values. Unexpected percentage non-missing represents the percentage of row violated the rule including missing values. Partial unexpected list represents example of rows violated the rule. And the last image on the bottom shows a statistical and distributional analysis with a quantile and histogram measurements. AWS DQ is an open source data quality library developed by Amazon. It is built on top of Apache Spark, so it is scalable and great at handling big data. DQ can be used for Scala as well as Python-based pipelines. It allows you to calculate data quality metrics on your dataset and define and verify quality constraints and be informed about changes in the data distribution. There are various metric options for AI purposes, such as standard deviation, correlation, histogram, entropy, and approx quantile. Before getting started to talk about DQ's features, let me touch on what features are missing in AWS DQ. Firstly, AWS DQ doesn't provide any scheduling mechanism in itself due to being a library-based solution. However, as long as you can trigger a Spark process, you will be able to trigger DQ validation process. Secondly, DQ provides validation metrics collection. However, in order to monitor how your data changes by time, you have to generate your own dashboards because there is no ready-to-use dashboards coming with DQ. And the last but not least one is DQ doesn't have any built-in alerting mechanism. Hence, in case you don't have any ready-to-use automated alerting mechanism, you will have to write some custom codes. These are the features that DQ provides. Automated constraint suggestion is a really interesting and useful feature. Adding validation checks on a dataset with hundreds of columns or on a large number of datasets can be challenging. With this feature, DQ tries to make our tasks easier. It analyzes the data distribution and based on that, suggests potential useful constraints that can be used as validation checks. Data profiling is another data analyzing feature of AWS DQ. In case we need to analyze based on a specific metric like entropy that hasn't been in constraint suggestion, this option can be useful. Anomaly detection is a quality check feature of DQ that helps us to capture unexpected differences between dataset versions. For instance, we can define a constraint on periodical row count increment. In case increasing row count is higher than we expect, it is going to be caught. Threshold check is another quality check feature. With this feature, we can set threshold values for the constraints. In case these thresholds are exceeded, it is going to be detected by DQ. And the last but not least one is metric repository, which helps us collecting all validation results of dataset snapshots. We can store these metrics on an object storage or HDFS, then create dashboards on them. These code snippets are example of how automated constraint suggestion can be defined in Scala. At the top image, constraint suggestion runner is being called with your dataset and default rule set. After this code block run, constraint suggestions are getting rolled up. Image in the bottom shows us how we can print each suggestions from the columns. And the last two texts are the outputs of the codes. According to the DQ, there can be set two constraints on valuable column. One is data type check and the other is completeness check. This is just a simple example I collected from GitHub page. You can extend it as per your dataset. Data profiling feature is quite similar with constraint suggestion feature in terms of usage. As here in the example, the code block in the top shows that the first thing we need to do is calling column profiler runner with our dataset. Subsequently, in the second code block image, the result of the first block is getting used by adding different types of metrics such as completeness, approx count listing, data type, and analyzing columns accordingly. And the texts at the bottom are the calculated values corresponding to metrics that are used in the profiling code. Completeness 1.0 represents all rows are fully filled for production name column. And 0.75 represents 75% of rows are filled in total number column. Approximate count distinct values are the same for both columns. And data types of the columns are string and fractional. Anomaly detection is another interesting feature of DQ. As you can see in the code block, two different snapshots of data yesterday's and today's are being compared based on increase rate of row count. One of the significant points here is, in order to use anomaly detection feature, you must use metric repository feature as well. Because DQ will collect the metrics of versions from metric repository. In the code block 1 and 2, we are setting the metric repository as a parameter of user repository function. After that, we are defining a rule of increase rate as maximum we expected by using relative ratio of change strategy function. Sum 2 represents the increase rate could be 2 times higher as a maximum. If this value exceeded, which means that today's data count more than 2 times of yesterday's row count, it will be detected. In the code block 3, in case of anomaly, is being detected, it will be loaded metric repository and the result will be returned as a data frame. By the way, I couldn't fit all code block for this example into the slide. You can view the full version of this example in DQ's GitHub page. Threshold checks are one another quality check feature of DQ. In the example, the first code block shows that how we add data quality rules. In the second code block, verification results are being controlled. In case any of these constraints violated, it will be detected. However, the records that leads constraints violation won't be returned. Only we will able to see which constraint is violated. So you can see the definitions corresponding each constraint as a comment. Let's have a look at the comparison of the data quality solutions. In terms of diversity of data sources, AWS DQ and Great Expectations are so similar, whereas Griffin provides Kafka connector. In terms of data processing, AWS DQ and Great Expectations are able to handle batch as well as near real-time mini-batch, like Spark streaming. Whereas Griffin provides real-time streaming support additionally. In terms of engine, AWS DQ and Apache Griffin is running on Apache Spark. Whereas Great Expectations provides other execution options upon Pandas and SQL database engine. In terms of data quality dashboards, Griffin and Great Expectations provide auto-generated data quality dashboards, whereas AWS DQ does not. In terms of languages, Griffin is more like a platform and that you configure instead of writing code. Whereas Great Expectations and AWS DQ are library-based solutions, and both are able to be used on Python. Additionally, DQ provides Scala option. In terms of quality check options, Great Expectations and AWS DQ provides quite various constraint options, whereas Griffin has limited constraint options. In terms of documentation, AWS DQ and Great Expectations have good qualified documentations, whereas Griffin has indeed poor documentation. AWS DQ and Great Expectations are easy in terms of implementation, whereas Griffin is hard to implement. In terms of scalability, Griffin and AWS DQ are highly scalable thanks to Spark. Whereas Great Expectations is dependent on engine it's run on. If you choose Pandas, you may come across some performance issues. In terms of alerting, Griffin and Great Expectations provide email and Slack channel notifications, whereas AWS DQ doesn't provide any. So you have to customize it according to your architecture. As conclusion, if you need to apply one of these solutions to your pipeline, you should compare features according to your needs and figure out the answers of these questions. First one is, what kind of quality metrics do I need to ensure of quality of data? And which tool provides most quality check options? The second, which of them requires the least customization cost to my pipeline for having those data quality components? And the last one, which one has the largest users community and most active repository in GitHub? You can reach out to GitHub repositories and preparation materials through the links. That's all I want to present you today, leaving the speech to Alexander.
Yeah, thank you very much, Murat, yeah, for your presentation. It was really interesting. Now let's have a talk. I have several questions about this presentation. So first of all, looks like you mentioned that data quality was only in one place of your diagram. So was it really implemented in other places?
Yeah.
Or it was
yeah. There were other quality check steps in the modeling flow as well. But these quality checks are based on transferred file size or model validation metrics or model performance metrics rather than row by row accuracy checks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I also I'll notice that so you are using AWS, and are all these tools that you mentioned available, for example, in GCP?
Okay, I haven't tried any of these tools in GCP. I tried them with Spark 2 in Cloudera distribution. In terms of cloud, I confronted with some production level topologies in AWS and Databricks. In case you choose a library based solutions like AWS DQ and Great Expectations, they are compatible with your Spark version. It should be able to run on any Spark environment, regardless of being cloud or on-premise.
Mm-hmm. And what about license of these tools that you mentioned? Yeah, are mm-hmm. they free or paid?
Mm-hmm. There is no license process required for using them. All of them is open source. Just download and apply to your pipeline.
Uh-huh. And yeah, regarding those diagrams that you mentioned, you so looks like you using limited technology stack, and can be this data quality tools used on a different stack, for example, on mm-hmm. different Spark version or without Spark.
Okay. Did you ask the transfer of these tools to different environment, right?
Yes, to another technology stack.
Okay. I haven't experienced it with any of the DQ tools. But technology stack changes are big challenges, to be honest, that may possibly affect all data and artifacts. So there might be some compatibility issues that needs to be fixed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, also regarding these data quality tools, are there any pitfalls in the implementation or usage? What do you see?
I think the only pitfall can be the lack of SQL support, because Spark supports SQL language, and most of data quality check types can be built with SQL language. AWS DQ and Great Expectations doesn't support SQL based queries. Whereas Apache Griffin has ability to run SQL-based checks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, got it. Thank you. And is it possible to integrate these tools with ETL pipelines, for example, to pre-validate source data automatically or data after transferring?
It's possible. You can validate source data before transforming, merging, or writing it to the target. So it's possible.
Mm-hmm. And what's about minimum resources that are required for this product, data quality tools? Do you know something about it?
Mm-hmm. For these tools, all resource consumption is dependent on how many data quality steps you add and how your data size is. So there is no certain resource amount as minimum or maximum.
Mm-hmm. Also, you mentioned about this data amount. How hard is it to maintain data quality rules? What skills are required, for example, to add new tables and new business rules in validation?
I think all skills which are required for data engineering are also required for data quality engineering. So Python, Scala, SQL, and Bash, Linux Bash can be some examples.
Mm-hmm. And so you mentioned about skills to work with the data quality tools, and what about skills to integrate these data quality tools to the architecture, mm-hmm. to existing pipelines?
It depends on architecture you have. But common ones are automation and job scheduling, dashboarding, programming, SQL, and data analyzing capability.
Mm-hmm. And how do you think, is it possible that, for example, customers support these tools without development knowledge of the software development, so they can they manage it or support or develop something new?
Yeah. There are lots of tools are being used for data quality. Even some ETL tools have data quality features. But in big data ecosystem, it is too hard to find a ready-made plug-and-play solution. Without development knowledge, I think it doesn't make sense.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's all my questions. Yes, thank you very much, Murat, for interesting presentation. So thank you all for joining us today. Please subscribe us in social networks, in YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, and wait for our new events. Yeah, thank you all. Bye.
Sharing my experience with you was a pleasure, and I appreciate you and the rest of DataZen community for organizing this session. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.